Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu amma ba'du fa'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم
The Promised Messiah on whom be peace states that thousands of people have upon my hands repented of diverse types of sins. And thousands of people, after taking the bed, the initiation, have obtained such reformation and transformation that unless the hand of God purified them in this manner, they could never be purified thus. And I can say on oath, and I can declare that thousands of my truthful followers and loyal servants, after taking the pledge of allegiance, have acquired such pious reformations that each and every individual acts as independent signs. If it is true that in their nature from before there was concealed within them the seed of truth, however, that did not manifest itself openly until they performed the pledge of allegiance. In short, it is evident from the testimony of Allah the Almighty that I was alone previously. There was no community with me. Now, no opponent can conceal and hide the fact that thousands upon thousands of people are with me. Thus, the prophecies of Allah the Supreme are of the type that with them are found the help and succor of the Divine. Hazur says, today we observe that with the grace of the Almighty Allah, not thousands, not 100,000s, but rather millions of hearts has Allah the Almighty inclined towards the promised Messiah on whom be peace. Such signs of help and succor are being manifested by Allah the Almighty that where on the one hand this becomes the means of strengthening of faith of those persons with whom these signs occur. There on the other hand this also becomes a means of the strengthening of faith of the other people. At this time, I will not present the accounts of today. I will not present those incidents of heavenly support and succor, which as a result of the promised Messiah alayhi salam are manifesting with people even now. Rather, I want to take you to that era and amongst those people who benefited from direct contact and being in a direct company of the promised Messiah alayhi salam and saw his time, what signs they observed, and how they had firm belief in the words of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, and they were aware that they have been given the words of the Messiah of the time and all the requirements will be fulfilled. how Allah the Almighty guided those people at various occasions. They had to face opposition and the enemy, and they provided them with such responses from which it was clearly evident that the special help and succor of Allah the Almighty was alongside these people. What their state of faith was and how Allah supported them at all times, these are all clear from these accounts and incidents. Further, this help and succor from Divine proved to be a source of their strengthening and enhancing of their faith. The first account of the Sahaba, the companion I have taken, is Hadrat Muhammad Hussain Sahib, son of Mia Muhammad Bakh Sahib. He states and narrates the following, that perhaps in 1902 or in the beginning of 1903, the promised Messiah alayhi salam's appeal was accepted and some money or fine was returned, and perhaps this was the case of Karamdin Jelmi. So my father took 2 rupees worth of batashe or a type of sweet, and we reached Masjid Mubarak. Everyone had different capacities. It was his sincerity that even in that time, he took batashe, which were used as sweets, he took 2 rupees worth, which was a large amount, and reached the mosque and took his son alongside him. He said, because at the time the mosque was very small, there were only a few elder holy persons. The promised Messiah alayhi salam was also there present. The prayers were offered. After the prayer, my father presented those sweets before the promised Messiah alayhi salam and said, in happiness for the victory in the case, I have brought this. The promised Messiah alayhi salam expressed delight and said, distribute these sweets. My father said that until the promised Messiah alayhi salam eats it, I cannot distribute these sweets. The promised Messiah alayhi salam smiled upon this. He took some of those sweets and ate perhaps 2 or 3. He sent around half inside, and after distributing the rest, my father sat before the promised Messiah alayhi salam, that is after he had distributed his sweets upon instruction. He said, then my father sat before the promised Messiah alayhi salam and related, and he said, Hadrat ji, this was his manner of informality. He said, in reality, I became Ahmadi that day when the case of Martin Clark was decided, because Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Sahib Batalvi, who had declared Imamuddin to be the Imam of this mosque, he said at the beginning of this case that Muhammad Hussain in the mouth of a lion, because he would call Muhammad Hussain a lion, that now Mirza Sahib is going to be devoured by this lion. Now he will not remain alive. However, when I witnessed the verdict of this case, I said to Maulvi Muhammad Deen, that Miaji, he used to say to the Maulvi Miaji, that this has happened opposite to what you had predicted. Instead of the lion devouring the goat has devoured the lion in such a way that you cannot even show your face. Upon this, the promised Messiah alayhi salam laughed and said something which I could not recall. Then my father stated that Mia was so ashamed and became so embarrassed that now he does not even cross my path. But anyhow, he said to the promised Messiah, I have taken the pledge of allegiance. When Maulvi Muhammad Hussain learned of this, he came to me to buy firewood or fuel. He had a wood yard and he worked as a type of lumberjack. He said, first I would come before him with great reverence and respect. However, afterwards I gained derision from even looking at his face. He said, for this reason, in Batala was our firewood yard or lumberjack place. I was sitting there on a type of sofa when this Maulvi arrived. So he remained sitting there on that type of sofa. The Maulvi was displeased with this and said, Mia Muhammad Bakhsh, have you turned away like Muhammad Akbar? He said, you only come when there is some work, otherwise you stay in your place. In other words, if they have a need, they come and they fulfill their needs. The Maulvi said, it does not mean by what I said as what you inferred. In fact, Muhammad Akbar became a Mirzai. Have you also turned away? So he was explaining to the promised Messiah that I replied to the Maulvi, you first turned away, then we turned away. Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Sahib said, how is this possible? He said that I said that we always said the Friday prayers behind you. And many a times in the sermon, you said whatever Mirza Sahib has said in Barahin, that is Barahin-e-Ahmadiyya, that is all true. And Mirza Sahib is a great scholar and a holy person. After listening to this, we also considered and accepted him as a holy person. So what fault is it of ours? Maulvi Sahib stated, that is Maulvi Muhammad Hussain Sahib, that he was true at that time. I said, Maulvi Sahib, this is greatly astonishing. Does such a person deserve the right to be called a jeweler who does not fully recognize a jewel and just considers something useless as a jewel? This he quietened, and until today he has not said anything in this regard. That first of all, you said he was true. You are a great jeweler, so to speak, and you consider yourself a great scholar. You cannot even recognize a person. In reply to this story that he related, the promised Messiah alayhi salam said, what a lovely God we had, who has inspired an uneducated person in this way and rendered speechless a Maulvi. This is the help of God. Then there is an account of Hazrat Aladita Sahib, the headmaster son of Mia Abdul Sattar Sahib. He relates that I am from the nation of Hur, the children of Israel. Our ancestral peers or ascetics used to come from Kashmir. When I became an Ahmadi, they said they will stop me from doing everything. I wrote to the promised Messiah alayhi salam. The promised Messiah alayhi salam wrote back, these people will be destroyed themselves. They will not be able to harm you in any way. This is exactly what happened. Allah the Almighty's grace descended. The progeny of that peer or ascetic came to an end and he had no children. And he himself became blind. This is further elaborated in another narration. He mentions this peer or so-called holy person, that when I became Ahmadi, that peer of Kashmir, that so-called holy person, that I am not the son of Qamar Shah. If all his work is not ended, in other words, because you are Ahmadi, we will stop you doing from anything. I wrote to the promised Messiah alayhi salam, who reassured me and said, these people will come to ruin themselves. They will not be able to harm you in any way. This is exactly what happened. The promised Messiah alayhi salam had a woman, and for the sake of obtaining children, he did his nikah with her. But that lady died and he could not have children. And me, an employee of 10 rupees who had no children at the time, became the headmaster of District Bar and was granted children, grandchildren, etc. And even the person who works under me is earning 16 rupees now. He said, 36 years before today, in the month of Ramadan, I was in Qadian. After performing Tahajjud in Masjid Mubarak, I sat in the mosque. This is the scene that he saw. This was in the dream. That on the fruit tree there were very large fruits. I climb on a ladder and I hit the tree and many of the fruits came off. I became concerned upon seeing this scene, that may I not receive the plague. Then I was granted a revelation, which means that your enemies will be ruined. So when this concern was developed, alongside it, he gained a revelation, which meant that his enemies would be destroyed. So always throughout my life, all my enemies were destroyed. Alongside this, the promised Messiah alayhi salam gave me a scented or fragrant soap and also a prayer mat. So this is the scene or the dream that he saw. When he gave this, the promised Messiah alayhi salam said, within the dream, that keep the soap with you and give the prayer mat to the Amir of Kabul. When the promised Messiah returned from his walk, I wrote both these dreams on a note of paper and submitted it to him inside. The promised Messiah was so pleased by this that contrary to his normal routine, he came outside with the paper in his hand and he stated, these are your dreams? I said, yes, they are. He said, these are very blessed dreams, the first interpretation of the dream which has been told within the dream itself, that the enemy will be ruined. And the soap that was given to you, this meant that Allah the Almighty will cleanse the filth of your sins. And by giving the prayer mat to the Emir of Kabul, this means that Allah the Almighty will guide some worldly people through you. Then Qazi Muhammad Yusuf Sahib relates, after approximately 27 years of employment, and my pay rising from 15 rupees to 200 rupees a month. In fact, more than this, whenever any friend could not help me in any difficulty, there only Allah the Almighty would be of any help. And all work was carried out with the grace of Almighty Allah. I faced many tribulations, but I passed through with ease. People unacquainted to me were indeed going to treat me in this way anyway, but even people close to me, year upon year, treated me like the brothers of Hazrat Yusuf. However, Allah the Almighty caused every envious person to fail in their schemes, and Allah the Almighty always listened to my prayers. And in the view of Allah the Almighty, it was a good end that was to come to me. He said, some people of Lahore raised a false case of me insulting the Holy Prophet ﷺ, and they incited an innocent person to try and kill me. However, Allah the Almighty, in order to save me, caused the pistol to not fire properly. As a result, the murderer was arrested by a certain Ahmadi, and he was handed over to the police. He was locked up for 9 years in the jail. The enemies failed in their schemes. God was with us and He is still with us. The revelation of the promised Messiah alayhi salam came true that do not fear us of the fire, because the fire is our servant. In fact, it is a servant of our servant. Then Hafiz Jamal Ahmed Sahib relates an account. That Hadar Maulvi Sarwar Shah Sahib related an account before us. He mentions his narration. That being freed from the Dioban, Maulvi Sarwar Shah Sahib researched all the books of the promised Messiah alayhi salam by way of study. The truth dawned and opened up upon me. I wrote to the promised Messiah alayhi salam that, Hazur, if you permit, I want to conceal my faith because I am the Imam of the Jamia Mosque and also a Qazi. And this is my means of livelihood. The promised Messiah replied, this is not the glory of a believer that he hides the faith. In fact, whenever the truth is manifest upon a believer, he manifests it upon others. For this reason, I do not permit you to conceal your faith. Then I made a resolution that when I have to make it apparent anyhow, then I should make it apparent very clearly. So then I devised in my mind that the Friday prayers will be the time when I would reveal this. After the Friday prayers, I announced he would lead the Friday prayers in the mosque. That after the Friday prayers, all brothers should remain seated. I would like to say something. So therefore, regarding the claim of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, I mentioned how I had studied for 2 or 3 years, and finally I stated that the truth has manifested upon me and I have accepted the truth of the promised Messiah. Upon this, an elderly person stood up and said, wait, I would also like to say something. People said, say what you want to say. He said, I cannot say it just like this. Give the Quran in my hand. So people brought the Quran to him. He returned the Quran. He said, the biggest Quran, bring that. People brought a very large Quran from the mosque. It's a very large Quran with very large font. He put the Quran upon his head and said, brothers, you all are all aware that I am a Haji. I am facing towards the Qibla. I'm standing in the Jamia Mosque. I'm an elder and I have 1 foot in the grave. I have the largest Quran upon my head. I swear on oath of Allah the Almighty that whatever Maulvi Sahib has just stated, that is wrong. I have been to Qadian myself. I have seen Mirza Sahib that at night he, God forbid, was naked on the roof and he was worshipping the stars. Seeing the false testimony of this elder person, I was afraid, said this Imam narrating the account, that what will people think of me, that this person was a Haji. This is the state of the Haji, Hazur says. They do not even consider the Quran truly to be large. They just bring the largest Quran and give oath. In fact, nowadays the so-called ulama, they bring even more accusations of bigger kind than this. But anyhow, this Imam said, I became anxious and I fretted that what will they do of me? This person lied so much. In that time, another person stood up. Wait, I would also like to say something, he said. Then I became even more anxious because the first elder was ignorant, but this person who stood up was a Maulvi. And he used to give religious lectures all over this land. So I considered if he gives any edict, then it would be difficult for me to save my life. In fact, it would be impossible. So in short, this person said that, give this Quran of this elder to me. So he had the Quran in his hand and he said, you all are aware of me. I am not a follower of Mirza Sahib. In fact, I am a follower of a certain Pir Sahib, but I swear on oath of Allah the Almighty that whatever this elder said, that is all a lie. He has not been to Qadian at all. However, I have been to Qadian because Nuruddin is a very able physician and I went there for treatment of my brother. I have seen with my very eyes that there in Qadian, apart from teaching and reading the Quran and Hadith, there is nothing else, and all they are concerned about day and night is the progress of Islam. It is a sign that there are some doctrinal differences between us and them. But to lie to this degree and disgrace them, I consider that entirely inappropriate. So Sarvar Shah Sahib said, after this proclamation of this Maulvi, I gained strength and I left this place and I went to Peshawar, where Allah the Almighty provided better means for me. That liar, he was also falsified by another non-Ahmadi. Then Mulana Ghulam Rasool Sahib Raji ki narrates, when the first time the plague broke out and rats started to die in our town and certain people started dying, certain non-Ahmadi were fiercely opposed to us. They counseled amongst each other that if anyone dies amongst the Mirzai from the plague, then nobody should dig a grave for them and nor should anyone help them in putting the coffin in the grave. So I wrote to the promised Messiah alayhi salam. I requested him for prayers. Upon this at night, I saw a dream that the promised Messiah alayhi salam is standing on the roof of a house. After this, I woke up. Until the plague remained, the non-Ahmadis kept on dying. But through the blessings of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, not even a rat died in our house. When many opponents died from the plague, they started to realize that the opposing mullahs say that the plague has broken out due to the Mirza and his followers, but all the Mirzas are safeguarded. Not even a rat has died in their homes. Yet we, who believe ourselves to be true believers and true Muslims, we are being destroyed and are dying. After this, certain people would come to our house and request us for prayers. They would say to treat us in this way that they consider that perhaps people who verify the claim of the promised Messiah and believed in him may be true after all. And also, out of a fear of the plague, they were so scared, after which they would come and say that we will not say anything bad about respected Mirza Sahib. Hence, pray for us that Allah the Almighty safeguards us from the plague. So through the prayers of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, Allah kept us safe from the plague in every way, and 10 or 11 people of our house, with the grace of Almighty Allah, remained safe. To remain safe from the destruction of the plague was a prominent sign of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. After this first plague that broke out, many people took the pledge of allegiance who have now passed away. Then Miyah Abdul Rashid Sahib radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates that this is an account of Amritsar. Just before Jangi Shawala, a youngster by the name of Aziz was there. It was a Sunday. He called me out of my house and he started insulting the promised Messiah profusely. He said when Mirza Sahib died in Lahore, that his corpse was badly ruined and insects were born in them, God forbid, and started stinking badly. I said to him, you should have fear of Allah the Almighty, because sometimes Allah punishes a person for saying such things. This never happened in this way in Lahore. And sometimes these things rebound upon a person in this very life, and a person does not die until he does not face this very difficulty himself. After this, this occurred on that very night, that he was sleeping on the roof of his house. There was a tree near his house and there was no ridge on the edge. At night, for some reason, he woke up. The branches of the tree were spread out near him. It came to light that he wanted to put a cloth upon it, which he had washed. So his foot got stuck in it, upon which he fell down, and it created a noise. However, I did not feel the need to give attention at night. I just felt that those people who normally woke up in the morning, perhaps it was some noise relating to that. When, after the prayers in the morning, I came downstairs, I found out that this youngster, he had fell down from the top of his house at night. He was in a terrible state. In fact, he had died. And countless insects were walking all over his body. Because it was required for the police to come to lift the corpse, for this reason, there was a cloth over his corpse, and there was a stinking smell from his body and infection. Because great blood had emanated from his body, so many insects had come that his body was hidden underneath them. Hazrat Sheikh Zainul Abidin Sahib relates that 6 months passed living in Africa. There, a most dangerous illness broke out, which caused severe pain in the bowels. Whoever was inflicted with this illness, the laborers started digging his grave beforehand. Hazur says, where is this sound coming from? He said, there is not even one person who was inflicted with this illness and survived. Whoever was struck with this would leave off his work and would firmly believe that now the time for my death is right here. And the laborers would go to dig his grave as soon as they found the disease was inflicted in them. Once Hafiz Sahib was working, when he also was inflicted with this disease, Hafiz Sahib became extremely anxious. He left his work and came to the farm. He said, now I am just a guest of a few hours. I'm going to die. I said, this is not possible. You cannot die. The promised Messiah alayhi salam said to me, myself, that you will return from Africa alive and active. Hafiz Sahib said, perhaps these words mean something else. I said, there is also a revelation on the promised Messiah alayhi salam regarding you. It is impossible that you will die in Africa. In any case, he was very anxious. I said, will you endure for 2 or 3 hours? I should separate from you. He said, okay, it's up to you, but appoint somebody to give me water. I said to a laborer that give my brother water when he requires. The laborer said, shall we dig your brother's grave, as was normally the case of anyone inflicted with this disease? I said, absolutely not. It is a revelation of the promised Messiah that he will return to Qadian. He will not die in Africa. So that laborer said that you Mirzais, without reason, always relate the excellences of this Mirza. If this person survives, I will believe that Mirza is true. I said, my brother will not die under any circumstance. Do not prepare his grave at all. So then I departed from there. I had the Quran in my hand. It was my intention to go to my officer and seek 10 days leave, a holiday. The officer's farm was 8 miles away. The entire journey, I cried, I sobbed, and I prayed, and I read the Quran. There were wild beasts in the jungle en route. When I reached the place of the officer of the farm where I had to take leave, the clerk, who was a Hindu, did not even reply to my salam or give me any attention. Then I gave him 2 rupees. Because without this, nothing was possible to get done. Then he started being friendly. I gave 2 more rupees and said, enable me to meet the officer. I would like to take leave. He said, the office holder is sleeping. He said, well, oh well, I will start pressing the body of the officer. Then he will wake up, then I will cough, and then he will see me there. So this is what he did. Then he went inside. He said, salam, and he requested leave. The office said, these Punjabi people, he said a lot of bad things, that you people always go off to the city behind illicit women. Here you receive government rations. You receive a uniform. Then why do you need to go to the city to spend your money? Both these brothers are of a new faith, said the clerk, and you do not find any example like them of honesty and trustworthiness. So that officer became ashamed. And he said, if this is the case, I seek forgiveness. Forgive me. I then requested him that we are poor people. I've only come to take leave. Please take leave. So he immediately gave approval for him to take holidays. I returned, took some important utensils and boarded with my brother, and I reached the city, Abu Mbasa. He said it would take 2 or 3 hours, but when he returned, the brother was still in good health. He took him and went to Mombasa. There, 30-40 people had gathered together about Jama'at. When he heard that Hamid Ali and his brother had come, then despite the fact that we were poor and they were very wealthy, and they received an income of 500 or 600 rupees, they all came to welcome us, and they all met us with great love, in a manner that even real brothers do not exuberate. There he also improved in his health. Then Malik Ghulam Hussein Sahib Muhajir relates, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that after the evening prayer, the Promised Messiah alayhi salam would lie down in the mosque and the children would press the Promised Messiah's body. My son Muhammad Hussein was also pressing him. The eyes of the Promised Messiah was closed. Another boy, Jalal, who was a Mughal, he was also pressing the body of the Promised Messiah. He said the mother of the believers was also there. The Promised Messiah spontaneously opened his eyes and stated that Muhammad Hussein will become a deputy commissioner and Jalal will be feeding the horses. This is what the Promised Messiah alayhi salam in a scene and predicted his prophecy, that the poor person would become a deputy commissioner and that Mughal would be feeding the horses. When the mother of the believers heard this, she immediately went in and she gave congratulations to my wife that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam has made your son a deputy commissioner. So from all directions I would hear voices of congratulations, and the whole house became immersed in happiness that this poor son would become a senior officer. So after this, Muhammad Hussein passed the matriculation examinations. He stood first. The deputy commissioner of JLM gave him a medal of silver and received 2 medals from some other people. After passing his examinations, he obtained employment in the Department of Canals for 25 rupees. After some time, he wrote to the deputy commissioner in Rawalpindi, who had been transferred, that I am employed for 25 rupees in the Department of Canals. That medal you gave me, for which achievement was it for? The deputy commissioner replied that you will be called in 8 days. Subsequently, within 8 days, the deputy commissioner summoned him to Rawalpindi and employed him for 40 rupees in his office. Once I went to Rawalpindi, and Muhammad Hussain Sahib said, I shall show you the place where you were set. I said, if it is not difficult, then indeed show me. He took me to the office and said, this table and chair is of the deputy commissioner, and this table and chair is mine. And alongside both of them was a jug of water and a glass. So they were both side by side, whereas the seating place of all the other clerks was completely separate. I immediately remembered the Promised Messiah alayhi salam's prophecy and thought, this has been fulfilled. I have become a deputy commissioner. 6 months later, there was an opening of 60 rupees in a Calcutta office. People appealed that get prepared for this. I said there was only 8 days left, how can I get ready for this? But upon the persistence of people, I said okay, and I sat on examinations with the grace of the Almighty Allah and through His blessings, amongst 200 or 300 people, I came first and I was employed for 65 rupees. I received a pay rise. There were Hindu officers there. There were some disagreements and I moved. He said for the JLM deputy commissioner, he said there was a need for translation of a long poem in Punjabi and they were in need of a capable person. The deputy commissioner was advised by another person who was English that there is a boy in the Calcutta office, Muhammad Hussain. He has come here on leave. Perhaps he can translate this. The deputy commissioner called Muhammad Hussain and I went alongside him. We talked with the deputy commissioner. He said, where is your education up until? Muhammad Hussain replied, until metric. His wife, who is English, said that no, he will not be able to translate. A certain headmaster has got BA and he cannot translate. So how can this person who has only done matriculation translate? He said, give me as a trial some work. If you like my work, then keep me. If not, then do not. So he took these pages and translated it, and they greatly liked his translation. After translating the whole book, he received a prize of 200 rupees. Because he did not like Rawalpindi, he left his work and came to another city. Somebody said, why do you not go to Africa? He went to Africa, and immediately he became an employee of 300 shillings. In those days, one of his acquaintances wrote to him, who was a Hindu, that nowadays a barristry exam is quite easy. Friends should carry this out. Muhammad Hussain considered that he should leave employment in Africa and return. And he said, whatever help you can give, you should give for the exam. So I said, you can sell some land, you can take some jewelry. So he collected some money and then he came here to England. He passed the barristry exams in England in 1 year and started a practice in Africa and progressed to such an extent that he became famous all over. The Nairobi deputy commissioner took leave for 4 months perhaps, and Muhammad Hussain was made the acting deputy commissioner in his place. Dr. Muhammad Tufail Khan Sahib radiallahu ta'ala anhu relays that in 1897, Muhammad Ali Bhopuri was present. He was an extreme enemy of Jama'at Ahmadiyya. Wherever he went, he would give speeches against Jama'at Ahmadiyya and he would incite people against us. From the first day, when he had not instilled opposition to the Jama'at with great passion or great extremity or incited them to a great degree, he was generally preaching against them. And because his style of manner was quite appealing of speech, people would listen to what he had to say. And my late father, considering that perhaps he is reminding people of pious things, he would go to these gatherings, listen to his speeches, and he was acquainted with him. This person who would deliver these religious lectures wanted to take inappropriate benefit from this acquaintance. He was aware that my father had great respect in his heart for the promised Messiah alayhi salam. He felt that perhaps as a result of his preaching, he also may be influenced and affected. He thought perhaps it will have an impact upon me. So he said that because the son had taken the pledge of allegiance to the promised Messiah, he should remove me from the home. In reply, my father said, it is unfortunate you tried to derive inappropriate benefit from my invitations. You desire for me to evict this son, that he has left his previous ways and accepted pious ways, and he has left a way of not performing the prayer, and he now is regular in the prayer to the extent he performs it tahajjud, and as a result of following the commands of the promised Messiah Islam, he has developed pious reformation. You tell me, what impact has it been from your lectures? I cannot find anyone amongst you who transforms a person's state to such a degree in the way that promised Messiah alayhi salam, through his spirituality and holiness, developed such pious reformations in hundreds of people on a daily basis. Hadrat Amir Muhammad Khan Sahib relates that when I had spent 2 years in Vermeli, then coincidentally one day I went to a certain district or office. When I was freed from there, what do I see? I see a group of people from my original town come to me. Two or three people take me and said that a quarrel has broken out, and this quarrel between the uncle and the nephew has reached extreme proportions, and this is why the police have taken actions. And now this is going to court and a hearing will be held and they want to reconcile. But the police are not allowing it to be reconciled. So both parties want to reconcile, but the police were interfering unnecessarily. He said, I said to him simply that when both people are ready to reconcile and are ready to accept the verdict and all of you request desire this, then who can stop this? Write this to the court that we are all ready to accept the verdict. So they all wrote this letter of consent. Upon this, the police complained to the office holder that this low-level clerk has spoilt our decision. Upon this, the local district office holder changed the report. But Sardar Singh, the judge, who was a resident of a certain town and coincidentally was on leave, when he heard what was happening, that this person was being transferred, he took all the people of the place and they went to the deputy commissioner in Hosharpur. And he said, if with great fortune we were given an honest person as a local officer, we heard that the senior person is trying to change that person. We do not want this local officer to be transferred. So this Sahib Singh Sahib, he accepted this readily. But Sardar Sahib said that in front of me, in this notebook, write this down. Upon this, Sahib Bahadur Sahib took out a notebook and he then put this statement of change. But apart from this great endeavor and effort, Allah the Almighty desired mercy and compassion upon me that a beloved servant of the Promised Messiah should remain here. So therefore, a person who was greatly influenced by Muslims before that amount was sent, he sent someone in my place and tried to have me transferred. Upon this, quite a distance away I went. Only a few days had passed when I received notice that in your previous location, a great plague has broken out where you were originally posted and where you had been transferred from. In this small village, on a daily basis, 20 or 30 people would die. When I heard this, I immediately bowed down before Allah the Almighty. How? He had covered me and saved me and took me out of this fire. Hazrat Atam Muhammad Sahib relates that in August 1904, my late uncle took me along with him to Sajanpur. This was perhaps February or March 1905, when the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, one of his announcements, and we reached there. I distributed this announcement outside the school. One simple person or Muslim met me in the state and said, "The state of the Muslims, Ahmadis, will be rebounded." I do not remember the exact words upon which I responded, but the summary of that is that within a few days we will come to learn that will Ahmadis be rebounded upon or you. After this, in the evening of 3rd April, two Ahmadi guests came to our house, Muhammad Ismail, postmaster, and Munshi Ismail Sahib, who was an employee, and also a third person who was a non-Ahmadi, whose name I do not remember. So all the three guests and my late uncle, they went to a person who had become an Ahmadi, who was an uncle, who had invited them for dinner. There, approximately 12 o'clock at night, they returned. In a house that we lived, that was a house near the school. On 4th April in the morning in 1904, a fierce earthquake struck. But through the blessings of the Promised Messiah, no harm was inflicted upon our house. My late uncle, first of all, came outside the house. Babu Ismail Sahib and Munshi Sahib remained inside. However, they did not suffer any harm. Where my bed was, to the north slightly, and also to the south, everything else had been destroyed, but we were saved, and that part of the house we were in be saved, and also the boarding of the school was saved. All the boarding people of the school were also saved, because the wall of the school was adjoined with us, and everyone remained saved who was in that area. There was only one Sikh teacher who was new, and he had to go out, only he had a small damage to one part of his body, which was a very slight part. But in the rest of the city, apart from the house and apart from that school which is adjoining, there was such destruction that was unenvisageable. There was extreme destruction, and only those people saved who were there and who were poor. It is my estimate that in the house where there were 10 people, only 9 people would die and only one would survive. A certain person was saved, but his wife, brothers, and many of his relatives perished. Thus, these accounts were, on the one hand, display the help and succor of Allah with these companions. There, most certainly, these also demonstrate the truthfulness of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam and prove it. The Promised Messiah alayhi salatu was salam, regarding the truthfulness of Allah of him and the help and succor of Allah towards him, he says in the book Barahini Ahmadiyyat, Allah the Almighty has taught me a prayer. That is through revelation. He said, Rabbi la tazarani faradan wa anta khairul warisin. That do not leave me alone and make a community then in another place. Yatika min kulli fajjin amir. From all directions, all those provisions that are needed for hospitality will be provided by Allah the Almighty, and people will come to you from all directions. Then Allah the Almighty says, Ya tuna min kulli fajin amin, la tasair li khalqillahi wa la tasam minan nas. That from every path and from every direction, guests will come to you, and they will come to such an extent that perhaps you will tire and become weary from their numbers. So therefore I am telling you from before, neither should you become weary and neither should you treat them in a bad way. So the promised Messiah says, now ponder, in this time when this revelation was published, people, or when people were told, did anybody come here? I swear by oath of Allah the Almighty that nobody even knew me. Perhaps in a year one letter or one guest came. Hazur says, therefore, today, those people who use extremely profane languages against the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, if they are good-natured, if they are decent and sincere, observe. Look, the clear signs of Allah the Almighty, how they are with the promised Messiah, alayhi salam. How the name of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, how his preaching is reaching the corners of the earth and has reached through Allah the Almighty. For people to come with such passion and zeal to jalsas around the world is a living sign of the truthfulness of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. The name of the promised Messiah alayhi salam has exited out of Qadian and has spread to the corners of the world. If today there is any community who stands in defense of Islam, it is the community of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. Alas, if only the Muslim community at large did not follow these mullahs, did not fight with the decree of Allah, instead may they accept the Imam of this time, and may, if only, they partook of the help and succor of Allah, and that they become a part of it. May Allah the Almighty enable all of us that we should not only be satisfied with the treatment of Allah with the earlier people. Those people who join Ahmadiyyat new today and see the signs of Allah, may we not only be those who benefit from their signs. In fact, may we ourselves establish a connection with Allah the Almighty and personally see the signs of the help and succor of Allah. May we be those who enhance in our faith and spirituality. And may we be those who connect our children with the Jama'at in such a manner that this passion passes from one generation to the next. May Allah the Almighty enable all of you to partake of the blessings of Jalsa Salana and to become the recipients of the prayers of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. And may you all return to your home with those blessings. And may your hearts remain filled with the praise of Allah the Almighty, and may always also in your homes this spring of the praise of Allah remain. Now please pray. Thank you.
Ameen. حاضری کی رپورٹ جو انہوں نے دی ہے یہ
رپورٹ that has been given according to it there are more people who have come from outside countries than the local people there are in total just over 2,000 people who attended the Jalsa amongst whom women are more than men whereas they assumed that there were more men than women in any case this is the attendance report this must be many times more than last year now it should be that the Holland Jama'at increased their numbers and if 2,000 guests come then 4,000 should come in future